How are you guys doing today? Swell, swell. Well, prior to this meeting, I was on the phone with a Mr. Tom Brady. We were sort of going over plays about the game this Sunday. And I hope, you know, this talk serves as sort of inspiration for that, but not only for other things as well. The speaker I'm about to introduce is quite the magnificent guy. He's been the Vice President of Student Affairs and a Professor of Higher Education at USC at Rossier School of Education for the past 16 years. Prior to his arrival here at USC, he was the Dean at Stanford University. At USC, his colleagues at Student Affairs are responsible for programs and co-curricular learning and development opportunities that really enrich the experience in the university. He's a really, really busy guy. We're glad to have him here today. He's always on the run. He was on the run here. Should be on the run afterwards. And it's an honor to introduce Michael L. Jackson.
What's up, good people? Man, it's kind of a dull crowd. Try to get you going. Well, thank you very much, Christoph, for that introduction. I'm really pleased to be here with you this afternoon. I was saying to Varun when I arrived that when I was at Stanford University, Stanford had a What Matters to Me and Why program similar to this, and I was a speaker back in 1993. And I was reflecting on that experience and what it means to stand in front of friends and strangers, but members of the Trojan family, and talk about what really matters to me and why it matters to me. So what I would like to do is talk a little bit about home, work, love, and peace of mind, and how those areas, if you will, provide a framework for how I live my life and why I do what I do and why I believe what I do is important for my own peace of mind as well as important for the world. And I hope that these reflections will, to a certain extent, help you reflect on what it is that drives you, what it is that matters to you, and why it matters to you, and why it is important for each of us to make a difference in the lives of others. When I was young, people used to say to me, "God, you got a great smile. And I like your eyebrows." But what I took from that was I was open. I would raise my eyebrows to bring them in to show that I was wanting to build a bridge of communication to them. And as my life progressed, a number of things happened to me that were magical, mystical, and I think part of a divine plan. Now I say that as somebody who is mainly a believer, but sometimes not, because I, like others, have doubts. I'm married to a wonderful woman, Dr. Diana Akiyama, who is also a minister in the Episcopal Church. And I remember when my mother was nearing the end of her life, she said to me, "I feel like I can move on because you've married a woman of God, and I think you'll be okay, because I know you're still trying to figure out your relationship with God." Having been raised in the Baha'i faith, as well as the Baptist church through my parents, through my grandparents. But I remember as a young man, one amazing thing that occurred. We were approached about me going to a boarding school. I never knew what a boarding school was, never even heard of a boarding school. A school named Robert Louis Stevenson in Pebble Beach back in the early 60s decided that it wanted to integrate that institution. There were 360 young men, almost all of whom were Caucasian, a few very wealthy Asian students. And the headmaster said, if we're going to develop leaders of today and tomorrow, we need to integrate this school. Who amongst us knows a Negro family that might have a young man of high school age who could come here and begin this process? There was one person on that, around that table of 20 white men at that time. His name was Arthur Dahl. Arthur Dahl was a member of the Baha'i faith, and he knew my aunt. And he says, I know a woman. I think she has two sons who are of high school age. I'm pretty sure she's got a younger one who may be going into the eighth or ninth grade. He called my aunt and said, we've got this opportunity. This is what we're trying to do. Do you think one of your sons, I know you have a younger son, would be interested? Would you be interested in this opportunity? She thought about it. My Uncle William thought about it, as my Aunt Adrian. And then they thought, we're not so sure. But our nephew lives four houses down, and we think he has the kind of personality and the academic background that might be the person you're looking for. My life was changed in an instant. In an instance. I was given an opportunity to go to this school, given a full scholarship. And as a result of going to Robert Louis Stevenson School, I was then able to go on to Stanford University, University of Massachusetts, and do lots of things. But it was this magical kind of thing that happened. Had Arthur Dahl not been in that room, had he not been a member of the Baha'i faith and knew my aunt through various meetings, who knows what would have happened. Another thing began to occur to me as I was going through this experience. And it was, I actually had a role to play in the lives of other people. And it wasn't that I came to that realization through some thoughtful process. It was because that's what others began to tell me, particularly my teachers, as they began to talk to me and others about who we are and what we should be doing and the gifts we've been given and how we should put those gifts to use. And I began to get this image of myself as a hub in the middle of a wheel, and that I would be in the center and I would just be helping people in all kinds of different ways, and they would come in and out of my life and I would be in and out of their lives, but I would be a connection point for folks. And I remember thinking about this when I was in high school, not actually knowing how it would be manifested, but I remember thinking, wow, people are asking me for things. I want to do things for others. And I want to do things for others that actually make a difference in their lives. And at that school, I had a great experience. And my role there was to get rid of such things as slave day. There was a day where the seniors got a chance to buy juniors and sophomores and freshmen. And you bought them for the day, and it was a fundraiser. I forget what they were raising money for. And the senior could buy you for that day. And what you had to do was do whatever they wanted. Shine their shoes, make their beds, carry their books, get their meals, whatever it was for that day. And I remember there was a guy from Texas. And we played on the basketball team together. And he decided he was going to buy me. And I said, well, you can buy me, but I'm not doing anything. If you want to donate that money. And we had this, and he and I had this very interesting discussion about why I thought this was a wrong thing to do. And I remember writing a letter to the entire school and putting it up on, there was a bulletin board, just on the side, there, when you walked into the entrance of the school and you walked out to the main quad area, there was a bulletin board. And on that bulletin board, they used to do two things. They would post everybody's grades, every marking period, everybody's grades, all 360 of us, what our grades were in each class and how we ranked with each other. And they would also post what we called special orders. And the special orders were, you're in trouble, this is what you did, and this is what your punishment is, so that everybody could see that. And so I wrote a letter about slave day, and I put it on that bulletin board when there was nothing else there. And everybody had to walk by that and see it. And I gave my rationale of, you know, being a 15-year-old young man trying to explain to people why I thought slave day was not a good thing. But I remember I had this line in there about, I hate to burst your bubble, but this is not a cool thing. So that's a little bit about my initial beginnings of beginning to understand who I was. And then I went off to Stanford, and what I learned there was you really have to know yourself. Because during those days, in the 60s, height of the Vietnam War, lots of people wanted you to do lots of things. People wanted us to protest against the Vietnam War. I was definitely doing that. Members of the Black Student Union wanted all African-American black students to stick together and not associate with people outside of one's race. I was not for that. And I remember some guys talking to me and saying, you know, what are you doing? I said, what do you mean, what am I doing? He says, well, you should be hanging out with black people. I said, well, I'm hanging out with everybody. And who are you to tell me who to hang out with? I thought this was about trying to get people to come together. And if the only way people can come together is to stay within their own race, it's hard to get together with other people and develop relationships across racial lines or cultural lines. That said, I still supported the aims of the Black Student Union and the kinds of things we were trying to do at the university, but at the same time, I knew that I had to be my own person and follow my own drummer, if you will, and to develop the relationships that were important to me, regardless of race, ethnicity, or gender. But one of the things happened, another magical thing happened while I was at Stanford. My undergraduate student worker job was for a gentleman named Dwight Allen, and he was a professor in the School of Education, and he was the head of the teacher education program, and he became the dean of the School of Education at the University of Massachusetts. And I worked for him and other faculty members for about 3 years on a variety of research projects. I wasn't doing the research, I was just collating. This is way before computers, so you can imagine people bringing in thousands of surveys that needed to then be summarized. And so I would go in there several times a week and just start charting all this stuff. And he said to me one day, he said, you know, you want to think about a career in higher education. It's like a lightning bolt. I said, what do you mean? He says, well, and they began to tell me about it. Because, you know, when you're a student, and I know some of you students may think about this, but when you're a student, you don't quite realize there are actually jobs in universities that people do that are meaningful, that can pay the bills, that are fun. You don't know that. I was thinking I was going to law school because that's what my friends were doing. I had nobody in my family who was a lawyer. And he said, no, no. He said, I've watched you. We've talked a lot about various things. You know, when you're a student, you're not quite cognizant of the fact that you're engaging in conversations that others think are somewhat important. He says, I think that you would really enjoy higher education as a career. So I followed him. And I went to the University of Massachusetts and I got my doctorate. Another magical thing happened. I'm fast forward, then I want to talk a little about home life. I ended up becoming a graduate student member of the board of a program called the Committee for the Collegiate Education of Black Students. And it was a program that recruited, enrolled, provided financial aid, personal counseling, and career counseling for about 700 black and Latino students. And one day, the director of that program resigned. He was going to become the dean of what was then called the Federal City College in Washington, D.C. And so I was the graduate student member on the board, and the executive committee was meeting, and me and three faculty were sitting around the table, and William Darity, who was the dean of the School of Public Health at the time, said, well, geez, Rhodey's leaving. What are we going to do? One of us has to run this program. And I thought to myself, I'm going to run this program. It just came to me. And they looked around. All these, the other gentlemen were, and women were, tenured faculty members, very busy. And so they turned around, they looked at me, and they said, well, Michael, what about you? You're in the School of Engineering. You can run this program. I said, well, first, I'm not in the School of Engineering. I'm in education. Education didn't have the great reputation at that time. They said, no. I shows you how much they knew me. But they said, well, you seem to be, on an interim basis, you could do this. Then I was thrust into trying to reorganize a program that had millions of dollars, lots of staff, was very poorly managed, and I and others helped turn that around in a relatively short period of time. But it was my first experience at leading an effort to revitalize something that people thought was important and restoring credibility to a program that really was not doing a very good job by the university. There were students who were flunking out. People were not keeping appointments with them. There were all kinds of things that needed to be fixed. And I threw myself into that. They ended up doing a search for a full-time director. The one person they wanted was a guy named was from the University of South Carolina, the other USC. His name was Johnny McFadden. All these weird things coming together. He ended up not taking the job, and by then I had been in the position over a year, and they said, well, Michael, we think you should do the job. Again, some grander scheme bringing me together with others to lead an effort that was very meaningful for me, and I hope very meaningful for the program and for the university. But all of that also made me really try to figure out, who am I as a leader? How do I go about being a leader? What are the tenets, if you will, the guides for me? And I remember reading an article by an author on leadership written by a gentleman named James Richer. And Richer had three tenets by which he believed spiritual leadership could be implemented. And I want to read those to you because they really do provide a framework for me and how I try, we're always striving, but how I try to be a leader. And Richard says, we must have inspired vision, have clarity of mind, a certain amount of will, toughness, and intention. And we should focus, and others have heard me say this, on low ego and high results. There should be little, if any, separation between the leader and those the leader is supposed to lead or does lead. One must have trust and be open to the views of others. You have to have an insight into human nature. Great skill in creating people structures. If you think about places like USC, we're always organizing, reorganizing, trying to figure out what structures we can develop that will be successful. We absolutely have to have integrity. And we absolutely have to do our work in the context of one's own personal growth and fulfillment, and the personal growth and fulfillment of others. Inspired vision, clarity of mind. Just think about that. But probably the biggest thing is trying to keep our egos in check. Because if we do that, we're able to inspire others to achieve greater things. I think about the... you know, this big project that Patrick Bailey and Denzel Sweet and others and I led to build the campus center at USC. We could have never done that as a collective if we put our egos out in front and made it about us. Because it took 13 years to get it done. And if it had been all about us, we would have been in the loony bin or fired, or the project would have never come to fruition. Because we were focused on a higher result. And along the way, there were unintended slights and intended slights as we tried to have sharp elbows to make sure we could fulfill the vision we and students had for what that center could become. And I could give you lots of examples of something like that. So what matters to me is that I strive to fulfill this vision, live up to these tenets that Richard cites, and they're not dissimilar from the tenets that others would cite as ones that are important. But I, like others, struggle. I know I'm not perfect. I always, like others, have to, when something happens that I don't really like or I don't think is good, I have to first figure out, is it because of me and what I don't like, or is it because I think it's negative for the enterprise, in particular for our students at USC? By the same token, I wear the hat of being a vice president, so I always have to remember, that part of my responsibility is to look out for all of USC. So that's students, faculty, staff, alumni, etc. How many of you listen to the Grateful Dead? So there's a line, thank you, there is a song, and there's a line by the Grateful Dead that when life seems like easy street, there's danger at your door. It's always there. And that's always in the back of my head. Just when you think you got it going and it's smooth, some stuff happens. And you know the word I would use to substitute for the stuff. S-T-U-F, well, maybe too many words, too many letters. You can never be overconfident. None of us can. Which is not to say we live in fear. But we always have to, like I think about in the work that I do, we always have to be thinking about, okay, what could go wrong? And the reality is, particularly for the work that we do, there's 37,000 students here, and there's thousands of staff, so lots can go wrong. Lots of surprises can come about. So you have to roll with those surprises and that those things. All right, I'm just going to make an abrupt shift here. Talk about love. I can't live without it. I can't live without it. I love each of you. I love my wife dearly, my family. And I think we part of God's plan is that this wonderful word called love gets actualized in the way in which we are in community with each other. It gives me comfort and support. It allows me to have very deep friendships with a few people that I know I can count on. They know they can count on me. I don't know about you, but as I get older, I end up, I think, needing less friends. I want a core group that I can really count on. I once heard Bill Russell being interviewed. He was a former NBA player. Sorry to do a sports thing, but it was to this point. He was a former NBA player, maybe the greatest player who ever played, particularly at the center position. And he was being interviewed, and the reporter said to him, "You travel all the time, Bill. What happens when you meet somebody new and you really like them?" He says, "Oh, I have a good time with them." He says, but, and then they want to become your friend. He says, I got enough friends." He says, no, really. You meet somebody, you have a great time. You just feel like, God, I really want to be, but he says, "I got 5 friends." Guy says, no, really. You've met somebody, you've had a great dinner, it looks like they can help you with business. And he says, "What would you do?" He says, "Then I need to fire somebody, because I just have 5 friends. I don't need more than 5 friends." Well, sometimes I begin to feel like that. That said, I'm still open to the possibility of someone or some or other people coming into my life and becoming very good friends. And several years ago, I met a man who actually became a pretty good friend of mine as a result of being open to the possibility. But when I talk about love, there is community love. There was love for one's mate and life partner. And there was love for this world and the magical place that it is. And a deep desire to for people in this world to experience the kind of love that I or you experience. And when you think about some of the terrible problems going on in countries across this globe, and you wonder, I wonder, do they ever get a chance to experience love in the same way I get to experience it, or that you get to experience it? Imagine living in societies where there's lots of turmoil, discrimination, poverty, not a lot of peace of mind. So how I go about spreading that love, I believe, is the work that I do in this role as Vice President for Student Affairs at USC or some of the other boards that I'm on, with the goal of providing environments that allow others to thrive and fulfill their dreams and their hopes so they can go out and spread peace and love through the things that they do. Think about, sometimes this is hard to say, but think about, had the world been a little bit different in the 40s, the 30s and the 40s, and if Adolf Hitler had different kind of love, that society in Germany had different kind of love. You didn't have the World War I issues moving forward. How different might this world have been had he and others had different kinds of mentors? And the circumstances were such that that mad genius could have been turned into genius for peace as opposed to genius for war. Really not genius, craziness for war. So I wonder a lot about love and how I can be professional, caring, and loving, and to keep myself open to the possibility of helping others. So what matters to me and why, in a nutshell, is can I be open enough, humble enough, and caring enough to make a difference in the lives of others and remain a hub in the middle of spokes coming off the wheel? And those spokes are folks like yourselves and others that I will come in contact with. So with that as a somewhat not too scattered summary, I'd like to stop talking and open it up for questions and observations. And we've got about 15, 20 minutes for that. I can keep talking because I got a lot of stuff to talk about, but how about some of you? Any reactions to anything that I've said or any comments? Anybody have similar kinds of experiences? Don't be shy. Yes, Jacob, I knew I could count on you. Very thoughtful young man here. He's just got a microphone for you.
Thank you for speaking. Thank you for speaking. I appreciate it. You said towards the end, love is actualized through community and through the way that we commune. And right now I'm living actually with 20 people my age or a little bit older. I feel that manifestation of what you said, so it's much more it's much more than just conceptual for
yes.
me. I think, you know, it's interesting because it seems like love is hard-earned at the same time, especially when it is through community, because you don't always see eye-to-eye with people.
Right.
I'm interested throughout all the roles that you've had and all the communities that you've been a part of. How do I articulate this? When you're striving for that love, and in my mind, love is a reciprocal, it's a reciprocal deal.
Yes.
How much do you give until it's not love anymore? And then likewise, how can you still leave a situation where you just feel like you're being taken from, or a community where you feel like you're being taken from, and still, and leave in a loving way, I guess. How do you kind of keep that up?
Well, it's a very good observation. And I liked what you said at the end. You somewhat answered your question. You like, if a situation's not working out, you like to leave on good terms with people. And I would submit that that is still a way of spreading love, because you're not leaving mad or with some sense of you have to, you're, or in a, in, or there's any kind of vindictiveness. I didn't say love was easy, right? It's not easy. Even in personal relationships, you have to work at love. You have to nurture love. You have to respect it. It's not infinite. I guess maybe it's infinite in the universe, but there are limits to how much one can give without getting something in return. And I don't mean that in a selfish sense. It's just we're human beings. I have a friend who sometimes says, when I'm dealing with my friends, I seem to be the one who's always giving, and they're not giving back to me. And that's not reciprocal love. I said, well, you love them, but sometimes you got to leave them. Sounds like another song, doesn't it? I've had some members of my family with whom I've had to make a break because, as I said to them, I love you, but whenever I'm around you, it's turmoil, it's chaos, and it costs me money. I love you, but I gotta go do something else, and you carry on with your life. Know that I love you, but know the reasons why I'm not in community with you and in a close relationship with you. So you have to follow your heart and follow your own sense of what's fair. But remember, when we leave people, we may still come back around and be with them at some other point. So you don't, it sounds trite to say, but I think it's very true, you don't burn bridges, because you never know when you're going to come across somebody again. You never know. It may be 10, 15, 30 years from now. I am meeting people now in this role as Vice President for Student Affairs that I met 30-something years ago. But they now have kids who want to come to USC. So Luckily, you know, they may have been casual acquaintances, but you just never know who you're going to run into. Hope that answers your question to a certain extent. Yes, sir, Jim. How have students changed over the course of my career, and how do I want them to change? Well, I don't know that I want them to be in any certain way. I think one of the things